Where will it be struck?
My voices have not said, nor what will happen this present year, before it is struck. It is appointed me to strike it, that is all I know.
And follow it with others, sharp and swift, undoing in 10 weeks England's long years of costly labor, and setting the crown upon the Dauphin's head, for such is God's will. My voices have said it, and shall I doubt it? No, it will be as they have said, for they say only that which is true. These were tremendous sayings. They were impossibilities to my reason, but to my heart they rang true. And so, while my reason doubted, my heart believed, believed and held fast to the belief from that day. Presently I said, "Joan, I believe the things which you have said, and now I am glad that I am to march with you to the great wars. That is, if it is with you I am to march when I go." She looked surprised, and said,
"It is true that you will be with me when I go to the wars, but how did you know?"
"I shall march with you, and so also will Jean and Pierre, but not Jacques."
"All true. It is so ordered, as was revealed to me lately, but I did not know until today that the marching would be with me, or that I should march at all. How did you know these things?"
I told her when it was that she had said them, but she did not remember about it. So then I knew that she had been asleep, or in a trance, or an ecstasy of some kind at that time. She bade me keep these and other revelations to myself for the present, and I said I would, and kept the faith I promised. None who met Joan that day failed to notice the change that had come over her. She moved and spoke with energy and decision. There was a strange new fire in her eye, and also a something wholly new and remarkable in her carriage, and in the set of her head. This new light in the eye and this new bearing were born of the authority and leadership which had this day been vested in her by the decree of God, and they asserted that authority as plainly as speech could have done it, yet without ostentation or bravado. This calm consciousness of command, and calm unconscious outward expression of it, remained with her thenceforth until her mission was accomplished. Like the other villagers, she had always accorded me the deference due my rank, but now, without word said on either side, she and I changed places. She gave orders, not suggestions. I received them with the deference due a superior, and obeyed them without comment. In the evening she said to me,
"I leave before dawn. No one will know it but you. I go to speak with the governor of Vaucouleurs as commanded, who will despise me and treat me rudely, and perhaps refuse my prayer at this time. I go first to Buret to persuade my uncle Laxart to go with me, it not being meet that I go alone. I may need you in Vaucouleurs, for if the governor will not receive me, I will dictate a letter to him, and so must have someone by me who knows the art of how to write and spell the words. You will go from here tomorrow in the afternoon, and remain in Vaucouleurs until I need you." I said I would obey, and she went her way. You see how clear a head she had, and what a just and level judgment. She did not order me to go with her. No, she would not subject her good name to gossiping remark. She knew that the governor, being a noble, would grant me, another noble, audience. But no, you see, she would not have that either. A poor peasant girl presenting a petition through a young nobleman? How would that look? She always protected her modesty from hurt, and so, for reward, she carried her good name unsmirched to the end. I knew what I must do now if I would have her approval. Go to Vaucouleurs, keep out of her sight, and be ready when wanted. I went the next afternoon, and took an obscure lodging. The next day I called at the castle and paid my respects to the governor, who invited me to dine with him at noon of the following day. He was an ideal soldier of the time, tall, brawny, gray-headed, rough, full of strange oaths acquired here and there and yonder in the wars, and treasured as if they were decorations. He had been used to the camp all his life, and to his notion war was God's best gift to man. He had his steel cuirass on, and wore boots that came above his knees, and was equipped with a huge sword. And when I looked at this martial figure, and heard the marvelous oaths, and guessed how little of poetry and sentiment might be looked for in this quarter, I hoped the little peasant girl would not get the privilege of confronting this battery, but would have to content herself with the dictated letter.
I came again to the castle the next day at noon, and was conducted to the great dining-hall, and seated by the side of the governor at a small table which was raised a couple of steps higher than the general table. At the small table sat several other guests besides myself, and at the general table sat the chief officers of the garrison. At the entrance door stood a guard of halberdiers in morion and breastplate. As for talk, there was but one topic, of course, the desperate situation of France. There was a rumor, someone said, that Salisbury was making preparations to march against Orléans. It raised a turmoil of excited conversation, and opinions fell thick and fast. Some believed he would march at once, others that he could not accomplish the investment before fall, others that the siege would be long and bravely contested. But upon one thing all voices agreed, that Orléans must eventually fall, and with it France. With that the prolonged discussion ended, and there was silence. Every man seemed to sink himself in his own thoughts, and to forget where he was. This sudden and profound stillness, where before had been so much animation, was impressive and solemn. Now came a servant and whispered something to the governor, who said, "Would talk with me?"
"Yes, Your Excellency."
"A strange idea, certainly. Bring them in."